of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. So the gospel reading today, Matthew 13, 44 to 46, incorporates what we had on Sunday. So I'm not going to focus on that. I'm actually going to look at the Exodus reading. And what I found interesting reading it is two things. And I suspect that one of them is true almost all the time, and one of them should be true, but perhaps isn't as true as it should be. Did that sound cryptic? Excellent. Good. So the first thing is, so Moses, he's gone up Mount Sinai, he's spoken with God, he's received the tablets, he's coming down, his face is shiny, he's radiant, and the Israelites see and they're frightened. And I think that's true a lot of the time. When people are confronted by God, often their reaction is one of fear, because it means change. It means change. I remember talking at theological college about whether you should kneel or stand for the prayers. And one person's response was he felt we should kneel, because standing implies being prepared to change. He says it's like a messenger standing by the side of their horse waiting for the message. When you're praying standing, you assume that God is going to ask you to change, and since he wasn't quite ready to change yet, he felt kneeling was the more sensible option. There's truthfulness in there, isn't there? A lot of us, we want God to tell us, hey, you're doing okay, you don't need to change just yet. When we're confronted by God, fear is actually a fairly natural reaction. It's not to say that God is scary in the sense that God is out to get us, but rather being confronted by truth and love calls for change, and so many of us don't want to change. You know, so should you stand or kneel is a very different question. Kneeling means, it comes from the old kind of court system. You kneel before the king to show your obeisance, your submission to the king. Often far safer. So we need to decide when we pray, when we come before God. But we also need to be aware that other people who are confronted by God, by what it means for something to be sacred, their first reaction may well be fear. And when people are frightened, they get angry and they want to push back. Being holy, being a small vision of God in the world, means that some people are going to push back against that, because they are frightened, because it calls for change. That's also true within the church and without. So that's the first thing. The second thing is Moses' practice with the veil. His face was shiny, communicating what God has said to me, and then he puts the veil on. And a lot of us do that. We put a veil on over our faces a lot of the time. We wear masks. You know, different people talk about there's three masks that you have. There's the public mask, there's the family mask, and there's the personal mask, which is a lie you tell yourself about yourself. It's like, yeah, I'm a handsome man, aren't I? I don't know. We all lie to ourselves. It's fairly common. But there are three masks that we have. Socially acceptable, maybe a little bit more raw with our family and friends, and then still the lies we tell ourselves. What Moses does is he wears this veil. And what it does is it allows people to come close to him, allows him to interact with people. But he also then goes to God, and he removes the veil as he comes before God. He comes before God as who he truly is. prays, listens, and he spends time with God. And this refreshes the radiance. And he comes out and he speaks to the Israelites, and then he puts the veil back on. He puts the mask back on. When we spend time with God, we will change. But we can't afford for it to be a one-off thing. I can remember when I was sitting in what was called the Great Court at the University of Queensland, and a representative of one of the student Christian organizations decided to come up and talk to me about God, which I, at the time, I thought was just weird. In retrospect, I think he's deeply courageous. It's hard talking to people you don't know about God. That's tough. And you're at a university, and there's all sorts of different influences, you know, the Christian Society, next to the Beer Appreciation Society, you know. So he's courageous. He comes and he talks to me. He says, "Do you believe in God?" Yeah. Excellent. And we started talking. And part of the conversation was about, when did you become a Christian? What's your experience, your conversion experience? When did you go up the mountain, Mount Sinai, and meet God? Using today's Exodus reading. I'm an Anglican. So I started off about this big in the church, and then I got about this big in the church, and then I got some of my earliest memories of playing up in the sanctuary. I don't think it affected me at all. It was a real difficulty for him and for me. It was a difficulty for him because he had this background that said you need a conversion experience. And it was a difficulty for me because at the time I thought maybe I've missed something important. That's not the case. A profound personal experience of God is deeply important, yes. But it's not a one-off moment. Like Moses, we need to build the discipline of going back before God in prayer and study, saying things to God, but also listening, so that the radiance that is within us might be refreshed. And unfortunately, that's the one I think should be more true than it is, in that certainly I know there are times when my discipline slips. And I suspect I'm not the only one. We need to be more like Moses, going before God, vulnerable, before the Holy One.